Reading an excerpt from A Water End Democide. Gary C. Gibson, 1:38 p.m. Jan 31, 2005 EDT #6 of 35. Why don't gravitons just flow out of all dimensions as loop particles that don't interact with dimensional walls as a sort of Hawking radiation, and remove all mass/energy from the universe? The Iraq election is a milestone considering the etiology of events leading to it. I offer my congratulations to the people of Iraq and the administration for bringing it off. Yet readings recently in Ezra and Nehemiah, Haggai and other minor prophets have brought to mind the intrinsic problems of political stability and transition in Mesopotamia, as well as the history of Israel in being attacked by hostile neighbors as they struggled to rebuild the walls of the city of David. It should be hoped that an American withdrawal of military forces from Iraq can proceed in ratio to the need of the Iraqi government to have foreign troops to police their own society against the ravages of international terrorists. In the Old Testament scriptures it is recounted that God had repeatedly employed foreign armies to correct Israeli transgressions, and in turn the foreign armies were destroyed along with their governments by other foreign militaries. The history of the Middle East seems a progression in teleology that continued even to the modern era to allow the word of God and opportunity for salvation through faith in His Son Jesus Christ to be heard by the masses of the world. Even as recent of historical progressions as the Muslim invasion of Spain stimulated a more rapid and evangelical Christian response in Europe. The Muslim occupation of the Middle East retarded that civilization's development sufficiently to allow European nationalism to grow, and to withstand the incursions of the fierce Mongolians. As the faithless Soviet Empire withered away, some of the Gospel of Jesus Christ was able to re-enter throughout the former empire. Muslim fundamentalist challenges have prompted a renewed interest in correcting decadent elements of Western civilization, and brought the possibility of a nascent democratic action to the Fertile Crescent, albeit one challenged seven implicitly by an overweening transnational corporate force that presents greater challenges to egalitarianism than the British, and the Stamp Act did to Bostonians. Democracy is a political function of the union of individualism in common civil rights. Forces of socialism and neo-corporatism oppose individualism, especially internet-writing individualism, as do theocratic governments, ad hoc Pharisee hegemonic neo-corporatist transnational corruptions, and power cliques for themselves. History has so many paradoxes. One of the names for ancient Jewish leaders was Nasi. The badge of Adgita may have its leading phoneme etymologically from an ancient Persian word for god, Baga. The Persians and Medes historically were the Aryans that invaded the Indus civilization circa 2500 BC to give a different religious leadership and caste system to those interesting Indians that has lasted nearly to the present. Cyrus, it shouldn't be too controversial to say, did not provide for the restoration of the Jewish temple of God solely, he also repatriated all the statues and implements of worship to all the captured and pillaged people of the empire he conquered in Babylon. Good luck Iraq, may you have many millions of gallons of McCloskey 20-year self-priming exterior acrylic paint ahead of you, available at Walmart. Gary C. Gibson, 4:25 p.m. Jan 31, 2005 EDT #30 of 35. Why don't gravitons just flow out of all dimensions as loop particles that don't interact with dimensional walls as a sort of Hawking radiation, and remove all mass/energy from the universe? The question about what the oil of Iraq will mean to Iraqi individuals is an interesting point. In the United States, politics tend to become dominated by extremists of the left and neo-corporatist right that annihilate individuality, individual and independent opinions, and so forth from the political debate. Then, of course, transgender sexual preferences meeting transnational political corporations tend to eclipse mere independent and personally conservative political concerns and interests too. No one in Iraq rightly owns the oil fields presently. Perhaps the government could be said to own it, yet it is almost certain that transnational corporations will pressure the Iraqi government to sell out the 8 fields. Eventually restive Iraqi nationalists will seek to renationalize the oil fields to be on par with Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates. The Alaskan North Slope oil field ownership situation is a comparable case in point. The people did get a bit with the permanent fund royalty investment, yet who will do that for ordinary Iraqis? A permanent fund to distribute $1,000 a year, if possible to every Iraqi citizen, would be a good way to buy votes and loyalty for a new Iraqi government. Essentially, the Alaskan Permanent Fund experiment was a modest success, yet concentrated wealth time is diversified progress. Government ownership of resources sold for profit also tends to corrupt, in partnership with corporate kickbacking crooks, of course. Governments should conserve ecosystems yet permit fair apportionment or privatization of natural resources to citizens that should initially have some sort of aboriginal right of citizenship slash ownership worthy of compensation when public resources are sold. When government programs in democracies become profitable enough, bold predators tend to discover them as piñatas that are meant to be broken and banked. Certain unscrupulous advantaged concerns perhaps devise methods to yoke the public into financial servitude, and discreet efforts to become unshackled as leftism or anarchy. Iraqi citizens have never had a part ownership of the oil fields historically, and certainly carpetbaggers possibly duping US and British military forces into support may seek to dominate the profit end of the pipeline where possible. It may be a proud thing to be a US military personnel supporting neo-corporatism, and sometimes the citizens, yet may have little choice of resigning if their civilian leadership is goofy. Of course, the analysis of some Americans will tend to stop reasoning at Halliburton, Exxon, Bush, Zapata and so forth, trusting that faith in the oil extraction process is morally the high ground, and that only the left, with support from the gist of Lenin and Castro, could possibly see anything else than the halo surrounding Secretary Rice. Rice, you denied me admission to the graduate philosophy program, and VP Cheney, or the certain divine inspiration leading pre-GWB toward the promised oil fields, and some ahead, with talk of hydrogen vehicles out there, enough to obfuscate the next 4 years of oil lethargy, infrastructure rot, and the termination of independent issue leadership and progress from US politics. Plainly, the U.S. Air Force should be developing electromagnetic accelerators for heavy and frequent space launching. The Navy develop TMG cannon for ships. The Air Force should work toward the real cheap way off world. NASA and the Air Force are working with the Euros toward a lunar mission in 2008 and a heavy lift capability, yet it is EMG that are the way for the masses to get off the ground. The view from poverty perhaps provides a cold light that differs from the view from a continuum of comfort.